Hello, I'm Michael Tam, a GP academic from the General Practice Unit, Fairfield Hospital and University of New South Wales. Welcome to the first video of this two-part series demonstrating the evidence-based medicine process in terms of how it can be practically applied in general practice. These two videos will be based on articles in the Examining the Evidence series published in Medical Observer in November 2014. This can be read online at the Medical Observer website and on my Morsels of Evidence blog. You'll be able to find the web links in the comments. You can also email me for a copy of the article. The article itself is highly summarized. These videos will flesh out the process and demonstrate the methods and tools used. Now, there are four key steps in the EBM approach. One, asking the right question. Two, searching for the evidence. Three, appraising the evidence. Four, acting on the evidence. This video will look at the first two steps, the question and the search. Good questions come from real patient cases. My clinical scenario was Reese, a young man suffering from an adjustment disorder with depressed mood following the separation from his partner. He is otherwise well. He expressed interest in taking St. John's Wort. Is there any evidence that may be beneficial, that it may be beneficial in this setting? There is a method to asking good questions which are answerable. I cannot emphasize enough how important asking the right question is. A fuzzy answer to the right question is much more important than a precise answer to the wrong one. For treatment or therapeutic type clinical questions, we can use the PICO approach. Let's turn to the tablet. So P-I-C-O, the PICO approach. We need to identify who are the participants in our question. What is the intervention? What is the comparator? And the outcome that we're interested in. Participant, now this is our patient Reese, of course. If there was a study done on our patient for this specific question, then we wouldn't really be asking the question. So usually we have to think about groups of people who are similar enough to our patient that we think that the evidence would also apply to him or her. So optimally, a young male suffering with a diagnosis of adjustment disorder with depressed mood. Now, intervention, this is relatively an easy one in our scenario. That's oral St. John's wort. In addition to usual care, in cases where the intervention is more complex, for example, exercise therapy, it is very important to clearly define this. Comparator, in our question, effects of the intervention need to be compared against something else. In this case, my usual care would be to not use any pharmaceutical treatment. Thus, the best comparator would be a placebo agent. Something that looks like St. John's wort, but doesn't actually contain any. Outcomes. The important outcome here would be improvements in depressed mood. So, thus our clinical question. In young males living with adjustment disorder with depressed mood, what is the effect of St. John's wort as compared to a placebo agent on changes to depressed mood? Now that we have our question, the next step is to find the best evidence, and conceptually, best is the key. We want to have a strategy where we are likely to be finding the best evidence. This is the problem with just Googling the question. Popular things, which may or may not be good, tend to be ranked higher. I'll talk about what I did for the article. It is important to realize, however, that the context of the learning and the search is important. That is, there are diminishing returns to the effort spent on searching, and we need to be practical about this. What I demonstrate here is simple and good enough for the purposes of my article. If I were writing a journal publication, though, I would need to do a more thorough literature review. However, if I was simply looking up a quick answer between patients, there are potentially simpler procedures, and I'll talk about that at the end. First, let's talk about levels of evidence. The basic idea is that certain types of evidence are better, insofar as more useful to making predictions about future events, for instance, the effect of an intervention on our patient. Let's go to the Center for EBM website. The table, they have a table there which is a great reference. So, to find the website, just Google Center for Evidence-Based Medicine. There we are. cebm.net. And to find the resource, just click on the search and search for levels of evidence. There we go. First link. And let's have a look at the document. Let's look at step one or level one evidence, the best sort of evidence. Now we are asking a intervention type question. Does this intervention help? So the best type of evidence is a systematic review of randomized trials. But generally, that's going to be the best type of evidence that we can find. N of one trials are not particularly common. They're quite rare. Now, we can see that one step down or level two evidence, it's a randomized trial or a observational study with that shows a dramatic effect. And we can see some relatively less powerful types of evidence. It's important to point out that mechanistic-based reasoning alone is considered low-quality evidence, insofar that it provides little predictive information on whether an intervention is effective. That said, we should remember to be suspicious of a positive study result that lacks a plausible scientific rationale. The likelihood that a clinical trial's result is correct depends not only on the results itself, but also on the prior probability of the experiment's hypothesis being true. Let's see whether there is a relevant systematic review for our question. A good start is checking the Cochrane database of systematic reviews. To find that, just Google Cochrane database of systematic reviews. There we go. And a trick to this is to immediately go to the Cochrane library. The Cochrane website itself is a little bit disorganized and it can be hard to find things by searching. So let's search for our specific question. So it's St. John's Wort adjustment disorder. Now I've done this before, so I know that nothing will come up specifically. So these are some other trials, but they're not Cochrane reviews. There is a Cochrane review for St. John's Wort and depression. Here we are. But it's really only limited to major depression. And it is very questionable whether we should generalize results for those with mild to moderate severity major depression to those with other depressive disorders. For instance, we would not do that for antidepressants like SSRIs. I normally use TRIP database next. So to find TRIP database, go to Google and search TRIP database. There we are. And TRIP database is an EBM search engine. Now let's use the PICO search option, given that we've already formed a PICO question. Our population, people with adjustment disorder, the intervention, St. John's Wort, the comparison is placebo, and the outcome is depression. There we are. Whoops. Search. Right. Now, a quick look at the list actually doesn't find anything particularly useful or very specific. It's more general summaries about the management of depression. First one's even, it's not even depression, it's bipolar disorder. Now this is actually useful because TRIP database is quite a good search engine. It means that there is not going to be much evidence out there. So let's check out PubMed next. So to find PubMed, let's Google PubMed. And let's just do the basic search again, adjustment disorder and St. John's Wort. Again, nothing really clear from this list. Now, St. John's wort, various things, but nothing specific for adjustment disorder itself. However, if we look here at number 5, we have got some other terms that perhaps we should be trying. So sub-threshold mild depression. So let's go back to TRIP database and do that. Firstly, let's change that to sub-threshold depression. Again, nothing really useful comes out of that. Let's trial mild depression. Now, I won't go through each of these, but here it really looks like that the term mild depression is talking about, all the studies use mild depression in the context of the milder symptoms of people suffering from major depressive disorder, which again is not really our practice population. But skimming through, we find perhaps another term we should be using, which is minor depressive symptoms. Now, this isn't a term that comes naturally to me, but minor depression refers to depressive disorders that would not be diagnosed with major depression. So let's change that to minor depression. And when we do that, we see that the first study is probably something that we can use. After that, again, the others, the other just reviews and not specific trials, but this one does look quite useful. So a study by Rappaport and colleagues in the Journal of Psychiatric Research published in 2011. I did a further search as well, but this appears to be the best areas, treatment of minor depression of St. John's wort or citalopram. And it compared St. John's wort with citalopram and also with placebo. We'll appraise the study in the next video. My search strategy isn't that thorough, but good enough most of the time. It involves 1, whether there is a contemporaneous Cochrane systematic review, 2, to use TRIP database if a Cochrane review isn't available or isn't very recent, 3, use PubMed. This is fairly quick, but it does take some time. If I only had a few minutes, I would go straight to the TRIP database. Cochrane reviews will show up on it. Also, there might be pre-appraised reviews of your question. For instance, if you put in minor depression and St. John's wort, my article in Morsels of Evidence actually shows up at the top. And this, in fact, will give you your answer to the question. There are a number of other quality sources of pre-appraised reviews, such as DARE and Best Bets, and these are good value. If you can't find your answer on TRIP database, it is likely there isn't any good evidence available. If I wanted to seek an answer immediately, but can get by without one, that is a role for Google. I have experienced at times instances of what I call Google magic, and it's amazing when it happens, but you can't rely on it. Earlier this year, my registrar saw a patient who had fallen from a motorcycle in a low-speed MPA, was a bit sore, bruised, but hemodynamically stable and completely well. He did have microscopic hematuria though. Should we do some imaging? Microscopic hematuria, a blunt trauma. And the best bets, here we are. Best bet review on the exact question I really needed was on the front page. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in part 2, appraising the evidence and applying it in our scenario.